Welcome everyone again to our Sunday morning program here at the New York Society for Ethical Culture. I am delighted to introduce our speaker for today. Wade Davis is a writer and a photographer whose work has taken him from Amazon to Tibet, Africa to Australia, Polynesia to the Arctic. Explorer in residence at the National Geographic Society from the year 2000 to 2013. Currently, he's professor of anthropology and the chair in cultures and ecosystems at risk at the University of British Columbia. Wade holds degrees from Harvard in anthropology and biology and a PhD in ethnobotany. And I hope today he'll say what that is. In 2016, he was made a member of the Order of Canada, and in 2018, he became an honorary citizen of Colombia. He's the author of 23 books, including One River and The Wayfinders and Into the Silence, and was winner of the 2012 Samuel Johnson Prize, which is the top award for literary nonfiction in the English language. And he has a new book. His latest book is called Magdalena, River of Dreams, just been published by Knopf. The River of Magdalena is, of course, the artery of Colombia, as he explained, a corridor of commerce and a fountain of culture, the wellspring of Colombian music, literature, poetry, and prayer. His topic today is the unraveling of America, and I can't wait to hear what Wade is going to say. Thank you very much, Wade, and welcome to our platform.
Well, thank you all very, very much. It's truly an honor to be with you. I mean, such a venerable history that you have. And the topic that I'm going to address does sound a little ominous, the unraveling of America, but in many ways, I think it's a prayer for America. You know, ethical is a word that comes to mind when we think of the evening when President-elect Biden announced his victory. And I know that at least from the perspective of Canadians, we looked up at that stage and felt a great relief, if only because we saw before us a man who embodied decency, whatever we felt about his political agenda or anything. I mean, there was just kind of a return to normalcy that felt like a spring wind. But at the same time, we in Canada, and I think many people around the world, watched the electoral returns with some trepidation because, of course, what haunted me was, of course, the pluralities of the victories. We were talking about that before we began this morning, where the blue states went to the Democrats. They did so by overwhelming numbers, 34 points in California, like 40 points in Vermont and so on, Massachusetts. And by the same token, the red states went the other way for equally dramatic point spreads, 43 points in Wyoming, West Virginia, Alabama. And what we saw was a country where, you know, well over 70 million people, an extraordinary turnout, chose to re-elect President Trump, who presumably had been satisfied with his performance over the last 4 years. And there was a racial divide in the electorate that was not as fixed as some of the Democrats in particular thought it might be. But nevertheless, we did have a situation where 57% of white people voted for Trump. So there was a racial undercurrent to all of this. I think we all found profoundly disturbing. And it's hard to imagine how a country so torn asunder can find its way home domestically. And at the same time, how can such a nation that has done so much to lead the world, particularly since the Second World War, reestablish a level of kind of respect, particularly amongst the closest allies, where for most of us, I think if there was a Trump-Pence ticket in our federal elections, I really don't think that ticket would garner 3, maybe 4% of the vote. So there is this sort of challenge. Now, COVID becomes this lens, you know. It's interesting. I've been asked to write about COVID from the very beginning of the pandemic, and I really didn't want to because I didn't think I had anything original to say. But one day on our little island here off the coast of British Columbia in Vancouver, I was paddling my kayak and I just had this sort of sense that COVID wasn't really a story of public health, despite the tragic rates of morbidity and mortality, that it struck me that fundamentally it was a story of culture and in a sense of biology. You know, in a single spasm around the world, this microorganism, 10,000 times smaller than a grain of sand, literally commandeered the biology of our species, causing it to create it, not us. At the same time, we had a vision of redemption in the fact that we couldn't help but see in every quarter of the world that we are indeed a living species, a biological species on a living planet. And as we saw, you know, if there was one sort of hopeful moment in those early, early dark weeks, it was the canals of Venice suddenly becoming clear, the skies over the Himalaya, above cities like Karachi and Kathmandu and Delhi that hadn't seen the white peaks of the Himalaya scoring the skyline for two generations, the caiman blackening the beaches of Baja, wild boars in the streets of Barcelona, rivers running through industrial cities like Medellin, Colombia, suddenly appearing like mountain brooks and trout streams. We suddenly saw this extraordinary resilience of the world. And if anyone ever gets pessimistic, just remember where we sit on this time frame. If you took our entire lineage as a hominid species, I don't just mean going back to our immediate progenitor, Homo erectus, but all the way back to Homo afarensis in 3.5 million years ago. And if you took that entire lineage and reduced it onto a chronological map of the history of the world that was 24 hours in duration, our entire lineage would not occupy a second. So in other words, the world will endure. Whether the conditions will be such that we'd be proud to bequeath them to our descendants is another issue. But COVID didn't just attack our biology. Critically, it attacked the network of connectivity and community that is for the social species that we are, what teeth and claws represent to the tiger. And in a single generation, in a single moment, we saw this incredible vulnerability as to who we are. Now, pandemics always have a way of shifting history. The Black Death in the 14th century killed half the population of Europe, creating a scarcity of labor, which increased the aspirations of the peasantry, resulting in the peasant rebellion of 1381 that overnight shattered a medieval order that had been in place for 1,000 years. The Spanish influenza that came in the wake of the Great War, killing more than died in the First World War, including my grandfather, who walked out on the streets of Calgary on a bright morning and was dead by afternoon. That had a huge rates of morbidity, but again, it didn't have quite the impact because it occurred in a world already numb by the blackened remains of the dead from the Western Front. Curiously, in the summer of Woodstock, when 500,000 kids rolled around in the mud of that famous farm up in upstate New York, a very virulent strain of the Hong Kong flu killed 100,000 Americans. And in Berlin, they were using subway stations as emergency storage places for the dead because the hospitals and morgues were overwhelmed. But again, in 1969, we didn't have global travel. Most Americans had never taken a commercial flight. And we certainly didn't have the connectivity of global digital communication to spread the word of our common challenge. But I think that the COVID pandemic of this year will be remembered as a kind of a fulcrum of history. And I don't think its significance lies necessarily in what it implies for our lives. Certainly there'll be changes. It's hard to imagine how we will not use this incredible Zoom technology that was mentioned earlier to liberate our lives. When I look back on the frenetic travel schedule that I lived before the pandemic, it appears to me now like an almost violent hallucination. I don't think managers are going to pay this amount of money to coalesce people in office spaces. I think we'll be reluctant perhaps to gather together in darkened spaces with strangers in movie theaters. But you know, these things we will adapt to. I mean, change is one constant in human affairs. All cultures everywhere are always dancing with new possibilities for life. I mean, the fluidity of our memory and our capacity to forget is perhaps our most haunting trait as a species. It's allowed us to adapt to almost any degree of environmental or even moral degradation. And sure, the possibilities of financial challenges will remain as a shadow over the economy, but unless there's a total collapse, we'll see the economy rebound. But when I think of the impact of COVID in historical terms, what it strikes me is that it revealed in this haunting way a devastating impact on the reputation of a nation that has meant so much to the world. Now, when I had these thoughts and I scribbled them down that one night and I sent them off to an old friend of mine, Jan Wenner, who of course founded Rolling Stone, and the article appeared online on their website, and no one had any particular expectations, but it went absolutely viral, trending on that site for 5 weeks, attracting 5 million readers, generating within 2 months, 362 million social media impressions on the internet. Visitations to my Wikipedia site soared from a modest 150 a day to over 4,000. It hit some kind of nerve. And there was some suggestion that the piece was, you know, the point of view of a Canadian being critical of the United States. I didn't think of it that way at all. I thought of it more as a love letter to the United States. After all, I chose to become an American. I married an American. My daughters were both raised in the United States. I got all of my education in the United States. My father-in-law was nearly US president. My brother-in-law was a US senator from West Virginia. My own son-in-law is a naval officer on active duty as I speak. So I felt this was more like a family intervention. You know, you do an intervention, the most important thing is to hold the mirror to the loved one to show where they've actually fallen and to see what they've become. And that's the first step always, isn't it, on the path of rehabilitation. And in a dark season of pestilence, it seemed to me that COVID had kind of reduced to tatters the illusion of American exceptionalism. At the height of the crisis, when 2,000 people were dying a day, Americans found themselves members of a failed state ruled by a dysfunctional government at the head of which was a buffoon of a president who was recommending the use of disinfectants to treat a serious pathological disease that intellectually he could not begin to understand. And for the first time, the international community turned to America. You know, as a great comment came from an Irish correspondent in the Irish Times, he said that for all of Americans' presence in the world stage, there have been many emotions expressed about the country, good and bad, love and hate, envy and sorrow. But never has the world looked to America with pity. And it seemed to me that as American doctors and nurses were eagerly awaiting emergency airlifts of fundamental supplies, swabs, masks, protective gear from China, the hinge of history opened to the Asian century. Now, no empire long endures. Every kingdom is born to die, and those who do slip away into the mists of time can be reborn, as David spoke about the rebirth of Spain in the modern era. But it's true, if you think about it, the 15th century belonged to the Portuguese, the 16th to the Spanish, the 17th to the Dutch, the 18th to the French, the 19th to the British. And the British Empire actually reached its greatest geographical extent as late as 1935. And you can just have this image of these Brits all over the world with a map of the world painted more red than it had ever been painted before, drinking their gin and tonics, unaware that the floor had fallen out from beneath the empire. We know the empire was in competitive decline by the Diamond Jubilee. And of course, in the wake of the Great War, it was both bankrupt and bled white by that conflict. And by then, of course, the torch had passed to America. And as late as 1940, America was essentially a demilitarized society, even with Europe already ablaze in the fires of Hitler's war. Both Portugal and Bulgaria in 1940 had bigger armies than the United States of America. And yet within 3 years, 18 million men and women would serve in uniform in the United States of America, with millions more working double shifts in mines and factories. It truly did make America, as Roosevelt promised, the arsenal of democracy. But we forget what they accomplished. Remember that within 6 weeks of Pearl Harbor, the Japanese took control of 98% of the world's rubber supply. There was no synthetic substitute. Every Sherman tank had 20 tons of steel and half a ton of rubber. Every battleship sunk at Pearl Harbor had 30,000 rubber parts. Every mile of wiring at every domestic and military institution in the United States was insulated by rubber cut from a tree. And if we hadn't solved that problem, the war would have been lost on that one commodity alone. What did America do? We dropped the speed limit to 30 miles an hour, not for want of petroleum, but to protect our tires. And then the order went out to the synthetic chemists that if you don't find a way to make 673 million tons of synthetic rubber to replace our domestic consumption, not to mention the rubber we need to supply the Allied cause, the most important industrial buildup in the history of civilization, the war will be lost. Meanwhile, one factory in Detroit, the Chrysler's Detroit Arsenal, would produce more tanks than the entire German Third Reich. For every 5 pounds of equipment the Japanese Empire of the Sun got to a frontline soldier in the Pacific War, America got 2 tons across 13,000 kilometers of water. We built Liberty ships by the day, by the hour. The record from start to finish to build a ship was 4 days, 15 hours, and 29 minutes. We spat out B-24 Liberator bombers with 1.5 million parts in each plane from Henry Ford's Willow Run plant to the rate of one every 2 hours around the clock. And so there was this extraordinary industrial development. The furnaces were so hot with industrial output, we didn't even think about sending 500,000 Dodge trucks and Studebakers to the Russians, 500,000 Jeeps to the Russians, 1 million miles of wiring to the Russians, vast stores of food and 35 million uniforms. And Russian blood won the war on the Eastern Front. But the Russian armies marched into Berlin on boots made in Pittsburgh, 15 million pairs altogether. Now, in the wake of the war, with Europe, of course, and Japan in ashes, the United States, with but 6% of the global population, generated over half the world's economic production, including 93% of the world's automobiles. And this created a kind of a golden era of capitalism. And it allowed for a truce between labor and capital that gave us famously the Treaty of Detroit. It gave us a weekend. It gave us a possibility that a man with limited education could look forward to owning a house, owning a car, having a good job, sending his kids to good schools that were good in part because of the subservience of women. Remember that in 1950s, the only career path for a woman basically was nursing, secretarial or teaching. So people of my generation were gifted by these women. My elementary school teachers here in Canada, but yours in the States, were women in many cases who today would be running corporations, serving on the bench, acting as neurosurgeons and running corporations. And of course, that reciprocity didn't mean for a perfect world. And it certainly didn't mean a perfect world if you're a person of color, if you're gay, if you're indeed a woman. But there was nevertheless a kind of a reciprocity of opportunity. The highest marginal tax rates on the wealthy were 91%. It didn't mean that the wealthy didn't get around that with loopholes, but the message was there that everybody pays. My father-in-law was a CEO of Bell and Howell Company in the 1950s, and his salary would have been 20 times perhaps that of one of his salaried staff. Well, now, of course, that chasm would be more to 400 to 500 times a separation. Today, you have a situation where the wealthiest 1% of the population control $30 trillion of assets, and the lowest half of the population has more debt than assets. You have a situation where the three wealthiest Americans have more wealth than the poorest 160 million Americans. And in the wake of the Second World War, what had been a demilitarized society never stood down. It had good reasons. It had to fight a Cold War. I think Reagan was right when he described the Soviet Union as an evil empire. But at the same time, it meant that the country never stood down. To this day, we have soldiers in 150 countries. Since the 1970s, we have never been at peace. We have spent $6 trillion in foreign adventures. China has never been at war. They've built their infrastructure, pouring more cement every 3 years in that period of time than America did in the entire 20th century. And as America policed the world, the violence came home. On D-Day, June 6, 1944, the Allied death toll was 4,414. In 2019, domestic gun violence in the United States had killed that many by the end of April. And by June of that year, guns in the hands of ordinary Americans had caused more casualties than the Allies suffered in Normandy in the first month of a campaign that consumed the military strength of five nations. And more than any other country, in the wake of the Second World War, America celebrated the individual with iconic intensity. It made for great mobility and personal freedom, but often at the cost of community. And it was sort of the sociological equivalent of splitting the atom. In wide swaths of America, family life suffered. Divorce rates soared. Only 6% of American homes by the end of the 1950s had grandparents living beneath the same roof as grandchildren. An obsession with personal success and the workplace, with slogans such as 24/7, implied kind of dedication to the workplace at the expense of family, which accounts for why the average American father today only spends 20 minutes a day in direct communication with a child, and why that child, by the time they are 18, has spent 2 full years watching a video screen, contributing to an obesity epidemic so severe amongst our youth that the Joint Chiefs of Staff have written op-eds calling it a national security crisis. Only half of Americans in various polls say that they have meaningful social relations on a daily basis. The country consumes now 2/3 of the world's antipsychotic drugs, and the leading cause of death for Americans under 50 has become not car accidents as it always was, but drug abuse and opiate addiction. This perennial and controversial war on drugs that has cost $1 trillion only to leave a country with more people using more kinds of drugs in worse ways than ever before has also created a haunting statistic that there are more Americans now with criminal arrest records than there are with college degrees. And at the root of this transformation, sociologically, was a kind of ever widening chasm between those and who have and those who have not. And for two generations, American workers had to watch as globalization was sort of celebrated with iconic intensity, when every man, woman, and child was smart enough and perceptive enough to know that globalization has never been anything more than capital on the prowl in search of cheap labor. And sometimes we look back on the America of the 1950s with a certain wave of nostalgia, particularly those who kind of invoke an image of America that really never existed, but has to be rationalized to exist, to in a sense, mask some of the bitter resentments and even lingering contempt for the social movements of the 1960s and later that took in one generation, women from the kitchen to the boardroom, people of color from the woodshed to the White House, gay people from the closet to the altar. But again, if you look at the economy of the country in the 1950s, it really was a lot more like Denmark than it is the America of today. And so in a sense, I think COVID didn't lay America low. It simply revealed what had been long forsaken. And as the crisis unfolded, with another American dying every minute of every day, a country that once turned out fighter planes by the hour couldn't manage to produce plastic paper masks and cotton swabs essential for the tracking of disease. A nation that had defeated smallpox and polio, and which once again is ascendant in this incredible, miraculous quest for a vaccine, was nevertheless for a time reduced to a laughingstock by a kind of buffoon of a president who, of course, was advocating such curious treatments for a disease that, as I said, he didn't really understand. And it seemed to me that as the Americans sort of were staring into this mirror and again seeing only the myth of their exceptionality, they were almost incapable of seeing what had become of the country. You know, the republic that celebrated the free flow of information and fundamental to the democratic idea was free public education for all, today ranks 45th amongst nations when it comes to press freedom. I could name you 15 American major metropolitan cities who do not graduate more than one half of their public school, high school, senior class, despite diminishing standards. A country that once welcomed the huddled masses of the world. You know, it's important to recall that myths are not old stories. Myths are moral charters. They're aspirational. And of course, America never opened its arms to immigrants. Every immigrant group had to crawl ashore, but the point is they got there and eventually they assimilated and they became part of the American dream. And that those lines at the base of the Statue of Liberty really are the poetics of America, you know, and they reflect a vision of America that Lincoln had, you know, charity towards all and malice towards none. Well, now, of course, we have just gone through a regime with a president who celebrated malice towards all and charity for none. And the building of a wall along the frontier of Mexico is not simply a folly and politically offensive to the sensibilities of Latin America. I see it as almost an act of treason, because treason isn't when you simply alone give state secrets to a competitor or to an enemy. It's when you embark on initiatives that betray the very essence of who you are as a people. And the sight of Americans separating children from parents to the extent that there are still 346 kids that the Americans cannot identify the whereabouts of their parents. This to me is a betrayal of all that made America great, in the same way that if our first president could not tell a lie, to live in a time when there's a president who literally cannot recognize the truth. This represents a level of almost decadence, and I don't use the word decadence lightly. It means decay. And so, for example, when you see people flocking in dismissal, in denial of the medical recommendations by the main scientific authorities to open concerts or beaches or convention halls or to rallies, that's not a sign of strength. It's a sign of the weakness of the people that lack the stoicism to endure the pandemic or the fortitude to defeat it. When I think of the term decadence, again, I don't mean to be gratuitously negative, but you know, when in 2016, for example, when you had close to 68 million people vote their grievances, vote their indignation. This was not a monolith. This was not a racially monolith. It wasn't geographical. It wasn't a gender. These were close to 70 million Americans, and it was 70 million Americans in 2020, who were voting for someone who transparently lacked the credentials for the job, and whose only credentials for the job were his willingness to validate those grievances and target the enemies, real and imagined. And it strikes me that a vibrant, healthy, growing democracy is one in which people cherish their vote. And you may like one candidate more than the other, and you may even be influenced because of that in your vote. But fundamentally, when a vote is precious, when you've had a vote for the first time, you take it so seriously that you vote for the person that you truly think is best for the country, best for your people, best for the world in the case of a US president. And when I say the word decadence, I don't mean to be provocative, but it is a sign of decadence that people feel comfortable enough to vote their indignation, I think, in that way. Now, Oscar Wilde famously said America was the only country to go from birth to decadence without passing through civilization. That was a rather cruel quip. But there is that sense of a nation in decline. I mean, personal freedom from the perspective of abroad in America is a personal right to own an arsenal of weaponry, a right that seems to trump the well-being of children. Again, several hundred kids and their teachers having been shot in schools over the last generation ago. And the American cult of the individual seems to have come to deny not just community, but the very idea of society. It's as if no one owes anything to anybody, and everybody must fight to get anything. And what every prosperous social democracy defines to be fundamental rights, from universal health care to equal access to quality public education, a safety net, social safety net for the weak and the infirm, America seems to see as almost indulgences, even though America was a country that in the New Deal, in a sense, invented the social democracy. And you get a sense that America has lost in this chasm a sense of collective purpose. And flag wrap patriotism is no substitute for compassion. Anger and hostility, no match for love. Over the last months, a quip that really is to be credited to Robin Williams has passed around the internet that to live in Canada is like living in an apartment above a meth lab. Well, Canada is no perfect country by any means, but we managed the COVID crisis in a remarkably different way, and it's worth looking at. On July 30th, when the Americans announced a total of 59,629 new COVID cases, which at the time was just astronomical, it's now been dwarfed threefold by some of the reporting in the last weeks alone. But on that day in the height of the summer, British Columbia, where I live, again, we are metropolitan, urban-based culture. Vancouver is an utterly Asian city. We live 3 hours by road up from Seattle, where the pandemic landed in North America. We had dozens of flights coming in every day from Asia and China. On the day that the Americans announced 59,629 cases of COVID in all of our hospitals in British Columbia, we had only 5 cases of COVID. So what was going on here? Well, again, we're no perfect culture, but we're a culture of consilience. We're a culture where community counts, where flagged wrap patriotism really has no place in our national discourse. It would be inconceivable for a Canadian politician, for example, to run against Ottawa. That would be seen almost as a psychotic act, because Ottawa is just the democratic expression of who we are. And we're a culture that still recognizes that the measure of wealth in a civilized society is not the currency accumulated by the lucky few, but rather the strength of social relations and the bonds of reciprocity that link us all in common purpose. You know, we still have faith in our institutions, our healthcare system in particular, which is geared to the collective. I mean, it's flawed for sure, precisely because of its strengths. It's geared to the collective and not the individual, and certainly not the private investor who views every hospital bed as if it's a rental property. And I try to explain the subtlety of this difference to American friends with an allegory from grocery shopping in Safeway. And in the States, as many of you know, really almost anywhere in the country now, when you go to get your groceries, there's a kind of an economic, educational, racial, social chasm between you and the checkout person that can be very difficult to bridge. And when you get your groceries in Canada, you don't feel the same way. You may not feel that you're a peer with the clerk at the cash register, but you do feel that you're part of a bigger community. And the reason for that is very simple. You know that they know that you know that they're getting a living wage because of the unions. And you know that their kids probably go to the same neighborhood public school as your kids do. And those schools aren't financed by property taxes that favor the children of the affluent, but by block grants from the state, which give each student an equal step up in life. And thirdly, and critically, they know that you know that they know that if their kids get sick, they will get exactly the same medical care as your kids and the prime minister's kids. And those three strands woven together become the social fabric of Canadian democracy. And one of the things that I think Americans don't understand is that healthcare has nothing to do with medicine. Healthcare has nothing to do with public health. Healthcare is all about social solidarity. It's about sending a deep message to every citizen that they matter, that they count. And let me illustrate that with a very deeply personal story. When my mother was 85, living alone in an apartment in the capital city of British Columbia, Victoria, she got a headache at 11 o'clock in the morning. By 2 o'clock in the afternoon, she was being prepped for neurosurgeon. Her life that day was saved by an immigrant, a brilliant Indo-Canadian neurosurgeon. And by the time my sister and I got to the ICU, our mother was in a coma, but in recovery. And right beside her, there was one other patient in that ICU, a young farm girl from the province of Manitoba, surrounded by all of her Mennonite family. And my sister and I were thinking, you know, we could have paid for this procedure. My sister's a lawyer, I've done well. But that family would have possibly faced a choice between the well-being of their family and the health of their daughter in many other jurisdictions of the world. And in Canada, we say that's not a choice that any citizen should have to face. Now, the fanciest hotel in Victoria, the legendary Empress, has a policy that any Canadian citizen who has a relative in an ICU unit in any regional hospital in the city gets a free room for the night. So after the nurses kicked us out, we all poured into our rental cars and we went down to the Empress Hotel to a legendary bar called the Bengal Lounge. And of course the Mennonites don't drink, so I bought them juice or tea or whatever they wanted. My sister had a glass of wine, I maybe had a cup of beer, I don't know. But the key thing is we then did a toast. And we didn't toast our loved ones who had survived the day, though they were very much in our hearts. And we didn't even toast the neurosurgeon who had not just saved my mother that day, but with the same procedure had saved the life of this little girl. We toasted our country because it was our country in this moment that had brought us together. Two families from utterly different ends of the political spectrum, the geographical spectrum, the educational spectrum, the religious spectrum, and none of that mattered. We were united in the grace of the gift of what our country did for us through its system of compassion, which is the essence of universal healthcare. And that, in a sense, is a perfect expression of what I would say would be our muted patriotism in Canada. You could never have a Canadian politician wrap themselves in the flag. We didn't even have one until 1965. And then the country came to a standstill as we argued about one or three maple leaves. You know, the most perfect expression of our patriotism is a line of Francophone verse that says, "Mon pays n'est pas un pays, c'est l'hiver." My country is not a country, it's the winter. It's kind of the weight of the North that hovers in the imagination, increasing kind of spirit of consilience. Now, all of this is to say that if indeed the torch of history passes from America's hands, and particularly if it lands in the hands of the Chinese, this will not be any moment to celebrate. It will be no moment to gloat. America and the dream of America has inspired millions. The vision of Monroe and Madison and Lincoln could still inspire the world. This is a country, after all, that sacrificed everything to not just win a war, but to literally save civilization in the moment of its greatest peril. And if the torch of history does indeed pass to the Chinese with their attitude toward democracy, with their contempt for a free press, with their treatment of ethnic minorities, with their social index that measures the well-being and worth of every citizen against a standard chart of orthodox behavior, all of these things will lead us to be extraordinarily nostalgic for the best years of the American century. But when President Trump famously said that the coronavirus one day will simply disappear, what we really have to make certain is that what he was referring to was in fact the coronavirus and not the American dream. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Wade. That was a bracing reflection, reminding me of many reflections about America that were like watching a high wire act and always assuming that the next moment, the next step was going to be the doom. But somehow it works out. People find their balance. So we're a country of 10 Canadas, and we do the best we can. We're not trapped by our history, but we do somehow learn the lessons. And I hope we learn the lessons that
Richard, I love the United States, as I said. I know that. I want it to be the country of Walt Whitman, Abraham Lincoln, and the Grateful Dead again.
Uh-huh. Well, I guess it's impossible to go back to a nostalgic time, and that's part of it. We always seem to be reinventing a future, and it's always awkward.
But, you know, Richard, there's so many positive and very specific things America could do. Policies that would change everything. And it would be, I mean, for example, bring back the fairness doctrine. I don't know if you're familiar with the fairness doctrine. Do you know that? You know what the fairness
doctrine? For broadcast, even news. Yeah, it was sort of a violation of the First Amendment. But if you go back further, you find that, you know, publications were very partisan. Before the Fairness Act, and we seem to live to it. And years past, you go into Paris and there'll be 20 different newspapers, each of them from a specific point of view. And you have to.
But I think there's something different here. The difference is that we've come dangerously close to a world where truth is relative. Remember, Patrick Moynihan famously said, you're welcome to your opinions, but not your facts. And the combination of the demagoguery together with the terrible democratization of opinion and the anonymity of the internet and the tendency of algorithms to silo us with those of our own opinions. This is a pretty toxic stew that has not been confronted before, you know, in American past. I mean, but the point is there certainly are lots of amazing things that could be done that would immediately begin to, I think, create a brighter future. And certainly the main thing is bringing people together. I mean, it's so tragic. One of the things that it was interesting in the response to the Rolling Stone piece was that there was a tsunami naturally of commentary and emails. And those who were sort of sympathetic to the thesis of the piece were sort of saddened but determined to save America. But the people who were very negative spoke with a level of sort of vicious vitriol that was really haunting, but also it was consistently misogynist. And the article doesn't say a single thing really one way or another about women. And it made me think that part of what's gone on is that, again, from the anthropological lens, those three transformations I mentioned in terms of, you know, the changing aspirations of people of color, gay people, and women, I think most of us would probably agree that these were fantastic advances, but they were nevertheless the sociological equivalent of splitting the atom. And people were asked to absorb these remarkable social changes, even as the factory jobs were disappearing. And I think that to some extent, there's been a kind of conflation of the economic agonies that families have gone through as men in particular have lost their pride of place in the factory and in the manufacturing sector or in the mines or in the forests with these social changes that are identified with these urban elites. And I think that's, again, a toxic stew.
Well, it's a change of culture as we evolve into a different kind of society. It's true. Well, thank you very much, Wade. This is really, really wonderful to have you with us and to hear what you have to say. We're going to